the Lord our righteousness. You're the Lord our righteousness. Desired of all nations, oh, desired of all nations, oh, desired of all nations. You're the Lord our righteousness. You're the Lord our righteousness. You're the Lord our righteousness. The Lord our righteousness. You're the Lord our righteousness. Desired of all nations, oh, desired of all nations, oh, desired of all nations, God's great salvation. God's great salvation, Jesus. The Lord our righteousness, the Lord our righteousness. Lord, our righteousness. You're the Lord, our righteousness. You're the Lord, our righteousness. You're the Lord, our righteousness. Jesus, God's great salvation. Jesus, desired of all nations. Jesus, oh, God's great salvation. Jesus, desired of all nations. Jesus, God's great salvation. Jesus, desired of all nations. Jesus, oh, God's great salvation. Jesus, oh, desired of all nations. The Lord our righteousness, Jesus. the Lord our righteousness. The Lord our righteousness. You're the Lord our righteousness, Jesus. You're the Lord our righteousness. The Lord our righteousness. You're the Lord our righteousness, Jesus. You're the Lord our righteousness. The Lord our righteousness. You're the Lord our righteousness, Jesus. The Lord our righteousness. You're the Lord our righteousness. You're the Lord our righteousness, Jesus. Desired of all nations, Jesus, God's great salvation. Jesus, desire of all nations. Jesus, oh God's great salvation. Jesus, desire of all nations. Oh Jesus, oh God's great salvation. Jesus, desire of all nations. Rejoice, rejoice, all of earth. Rejoice, rejoice, all of heaven. Rejoice, rejoice, all of earth. Rejoice, rejoice, all of heaven. Rejoice, rejoice, all of earth. Rejoice, rejoice, all of heaven. Rejoice, rejoice, all of earth. Rejoice, rejoice, all of heaven. Rejoice, rejoice, all of earth. Rejoice, rejoice, all of heaven. Rejoice, rejoice, all of earth. Rejoice, rejoice, all of heaven. Rejoice, rejoice, all of earth. God's great salvation, Jesus, desired of all nations, Jesus, God's great salvation, Jesus, desired of all nations, Jesus. God's great salvation, Jesus, who desired of all nations, Jesus, who God's great salvation, Jesus, desired of all nations.
Lord, we stand and worship you. Lord, the great I am. The life, the way, the truth, we worship you. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord, God Almighty. Oh, Lord. Most High, O Lord, Creator of the heavens and the earth, we worship you. Hallelujah. O God, Savior, Healer, and Redeemer, O God. Oh God, the everlasting God and King, we worship you. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, oh, hallelujah, Lord, we pray. And Lord, we give you thanks right now. Oh God, we worship you. Savior, healer, oh Savior, healer. My Redeemer, Savior, healer. My Redeemer, Savior, healer. My Redeemer, we worship you. Lord, we worship. Hallelujah. Lord, we praise you. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, we give thanks unto you, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, hallelujah. We give thanks unto you, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, Lord, we give thanks to you. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, Lord, we give thanks to you. Savior, healer, my Redeemer. Savior, healer, my Redeemer. Savior, healer, my Redeemer. Oh God, Most High, Most High, Almighty, Almighty God, God Most High. Savior, healer, my Redeemer. Savior, healer, my Redeemer. We worship you. Oh, hallelujah. We praise you, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Savior, healer, my Redeemer. Savior, healer, my Redeemer. Savior, healer, my You're the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, which is and was and is to come, the Almighty. Oh, Alpha and Omega, beginning and the end, which is and was and is to come, the Almighty. You're the Alpha and Omega, beginning and the end, which is and was and is to come, the Almighty. You're the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, which is and was and is to come, the Almighty. Hallelujah. We thank you. Hallelujah, we praise your name, Lord. Oh, hallelujah, we thank you, Jesus. ahead and praise him now. Go ahead and worship him. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. We give thanks unto you. Hallelujah. We praise your name, Almighty. Oh, hallelujah. We give thanks unto you. Oh, hallelujah. We praise your name, Almighty. Hallelujah. Well, I hope that you are just, your heart set and fixed on being a part of what God the Holy Ghost is doing. There are a lot of people that are, their hearts are fixed on doing what they think is good to do, what they believe is acceptable. But God the Holy Ghost, he's doing amazing things. He's doing signs and wonders and miracles. He's doing tongues, interpretation of tongues and prophecies. He's doing word of wisdom, word of knowledge, discerning of spirits. He's glorifying Jesus. He's manifesting heaven. He's showing that there's something far greater than that which can be done by man in a natural realm. That there's a resurrected glory that Christ Jesus has brought to everyone who receives. And you know, all the nations desire Jesus right now. They just don't really understand it or articulate it that way. They all desire a Savior. They all desire some solution to their poverty, especially. Some solution to their famine, to their hunger, to their war, to their turmoil, to their disaster, to their crisis. So every nation wants judgment. They want truth. They want equity. They just want it on their terms. The progressive liberals believe that that's what they're providing. The conservatives believe in America that that's what they're providing. The communists and People's Republic of China believe that that's what they're providing. Those various different groups that are revolting against the People's Republic of China believe that that's what they're offering. ISIS believes that that's what they're wanting to provide. All of the nations everywhere, all of their ideology, all of their religions, all of the philosophies, all the political ideas are founded on the basis that somehow this is going to be the solution and the answer to people's crisis and needs. It's going to be their Savior, their solution. All nations desire him. He's the desire of all nations, desired by all nations. Today, we're here to challenge you. Do you want a Savior? Do you want a healer? Do you want a redeemer? Do you want one who will solve your crisis? Do you want one who will bring to you justice and truth and equity? Do you want one who will bring you into a place of safety where all of the realms of the demonic and death and destruction and everything that is opposed to everything that you value and that you hold dear and that is good can no longer threaten you and claim you? Yes. Two nods, one yes. Yes, three I hope so's. Yes. Then you have to decide whether or not you're going to have a Savior and a Redeemer on the basis of what you believe, on the basis of God having to meet your sets of criteria and conditions, whether you're going to come to him and let him show you how it's done. Hallelujah. Today, he's my desire. I pray that he is your desire. Hallelujah. Three hand claps, four hands raised. I hope you guys are more enthusiastic on Christmas morning. If I were in your house on Christmas morning and you were acting like this, I would say something terribly wrong in the place. It's not Halloween, it's Christmas. Hallelujah. Amen. No, it will take a radical people. It won't. People that are going to just stand around with their hands drooped to their side, it ain't going to work. people are going to be willing to be silent, it ain't going to work. It's going to take a radical people to see the move of God take place to break off the strongholds, because otherwise they're just, all you're going to do is beget a few, well, beget a few people that act like us. And there'll be no lasting change brought. I want you to be seated, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit, and by the help and the grace of God, those of you who do not know this wonderful relationship with Jesus Christ, you'll come to know it. So many people have called upon the name of the Lord Jesus, but they've never really entered into the joy of the salvation. They've never entered into the goodness of the relationship, and always things belonging to sin and iniquity has a bigger pull than the presence of the Lord. And that's a sad testimony against what we're offering. And we pray, God, in Jesus' name, there will be more than one or two or three, four people on the earth that have something more to supply than just another religious ditty, another little thing to occupy your Sundays, another little thing to salve whatever goes on in your life that you feel bad about and you need a conscience crutch. You know, we were talking the other day about some of the churches, some of our friends pastor that are more than 4,000 or 5,000 people. We have one friend as pastor in a church, is over 8,000 people, and you know, there's 6 services on Sunday morning, so you can do the math. And you know, when you had 6 services on Sunday morning, you just start at 9, come on, okay? But really, that's basically what is popular. Just, you know, come on, give me one little nugget of something to basically make me feel better about what I'm having to deal with on a daily basis, and give me some hope for some success. And say a little prayer over me, let me do a Pentecostal genuflex so that I feel like that somehow, you know, all my wrongdoings are justified. And unfortunately, I hate to say it that way, but in too many people, and I think that if I sort most people out, that's really where it goes to. If we really break it all down and we deal with the truth, people aren't wanting their sins to be purified and done away with. They want them to be justified. They want to be able to continue on in it and be okay, be right with God. And you know, today I'm going to talk to you about judgment along with mercy. Because when there is no mercy with judgment, then all you have is strict justice, and every one of your sins must be paid for in full. Some people have if every sin is equal to worthy of death, I mean, think about how many deaths you're worthy of. And of course, God's law says that every sin is worthy of death. How high are they stacked, and how much higher are you going to stack them? And how much more are you going to push the limits of God's mercy? God's mercy is amazing. Hallelujah, His mercy is amazing. But you know, the thing about it is when you come to God for mercy, but you don't want to learn what's right, then your judgment is the judgment and the justice executed against you is actually greater. And Jesus talked about that in Matthew chapter 18 when He dealt with the man who was forgiven of much, forgiven of millions of dollars. And because the man owed millions of dollars, he wasn't able to pay it. And he says, okay, I'm going to take your wife. I'm going to take your children. I'm taking everything from you. And I'm going to throw you in prison until the debt's paid. I'm taking everything that you have. I'm going to put them into slavery. Get whatever money I can get off of the sale of all of your property. I'm going to put you into prison. And you're going to go to work in prison for me until the debt is fully paid. But it was more than a debt that his lifetime and all that he possessed could compensate. And he came pleading for mercy. Justice demanded all of those things. Justice, the execution of justice in the right judgments of the contracts and the covenant and what was already each person bound to, demanded he do all those things, but he pled for mercy. And in that plea for mercy, because there was a merciful owner, there was a merciful person in charge of all of these things. He showed him mercy, forgave him all of his debt. But this man who sought mercy found that his mercy was only temporal. Why? Because he was not learning, he was not willing to learn to do what was right. He received mercy, but was not willing to do what was right. And so his judgment in the end was greater. What did he do? He went and grabbed one of his fellow servants by the throat who owed him a couple of bucks. Compared to his millions of dollars of debt, owed him a couple of bucks, maybe, you know, $100, and demanded that he pay it all. And when the guy wasn't able to come up with it, he threw him to the tormentors. And not willing to show mercy. The Lord says, if you're not willing to show mercy, if you're not willing to do what's right, if you're not willing to walk in judgment, you're not going to receive mercy. You're not going to receive right standing. And I want to talk to you about these things this morning, because first and foremost, I want you to understand that God in His great love brought for us a sacrifice for sin, Christ Jesus, a lamb, a redeemer, the redeemer. And in that, God did something for us that is so amazing. Romans chapter 5 describes it to us, whereas Adam's sin came upon us and we didn't do anything to deserve it. We weren't there. We didn't decide with him, you know, to disobey God. Yet that sin came upon us in like manner because of Jesus' obedience. An obedience and a righteousness came upon us. Everybody who would receive and everybody who would believe. So today, I stand in a righteousness. He that does what is right, that he that does righteousness is righteous even as he is righteous. I have a righteousness that is not my own. It is a righteousness given to me, both imputed and imparted. It is accounted unto me and it is imparted to me. So I stand before God with God's very own righteousness. The righteousness of God is now manifested without the law being witnessed by the prophets. This is something that Paul said in Romans chapter 3, verses 21 through 25 is the summation of it. 24 being the heart of it. I stand right now with the righteousness of God. I have His righteousness. It's not my own righteousness. My interaction with God is viewed in the purest of righteousness. So the Lord can say to me, be righteous, even as I am righteous. And I can say, yes, because it's all in Christ Jesus. I'm in Him and He's in me. God can say to me, be holy, even as I am holy. And I can go, wow, that's just impossible. Or I can say, my, I see my Redeemer lives, and my holiness is a holiness that belongs to Him. It's mine. It's always there. It's mine. But if I receive the gift of righteousness and I receive the gift of holiness, and I'm not willing to learn righteousness, and I'm not willing to learn holiness, then I'm a rebel against the kingdom. Because it was given to me so that I'm not having to earn a standing. I'm not having, you know, my righteousness or right doing or being willing to be led by the Holy Spirit isn't ultimately going to result in a better standing with God as I become more perfect at it. Always I stand in His righteousness, overwhelmed by the Lord, my righteousness, overwhelmed by the holiness of God. I mean, I love to go back and look at what God does in the covenant like He did with Abraham. When He said to Abraham, Abraham, I am El Shaddai, I'm God Almighty. In other words, I am the sovereign, absolute power of the universe, the creator of everything that exists. Walk before me and be perfect. And people look at that and they go, wow, what a burden and obligation. My goodness, what a crisis. How are we ever going to get this? And what happens if we fail one time? No, Father empowered him. By the covenant, God empowered him. Hallelujah. God empowers you and me. It is amazing in this wonderful, blessed hope that we have of the resurrection, an expectation and the confidence of the resurrection. We stand perfectly holy and acceptable unto God. And if we'll just be what God demands, faithful, because God is the God of mercy and truth. It said over and again, but the word for truth, much of the time when those two are paired together, is actually a word that is better translated faithfulness. God is a God of mercy and faithfulness. And He's and it's something that he's dedicated to giving to us. Amen. So that we give it to one another. Amen. And it's something that is found in this wonderful fellowship of His love. Something that can only be expressed to you and me when we walk in humility and brokenness. And as long as we just are high on ourselves and we think so something so special of ourselves, we're not going to give it. We'll never know how to give it. We'll be able to diagram it. We'll be able to talk about it. We'll be able to discuss it. We'll be able to reference it from the Bible, but we'll never be able to show it. Because what's on the inside of you is going to come out whether you like it or not. God wants to put on something so glorious on the inside of you so that you can be clothed with it on the outside. Amen.
Hey, I look good on the inside, but you guys are glad I put something on the outside. Are you listening to me? You are? Otherwise, I'd be like the, you know, the prophet who had to go about, you know, without any clothes on, prophesy to Israel. And there would be even lesser, fewer people here this morning. I don't know. Maybe there would actually be more people. Actually, come think of it, the way things are. Yeah, I become the doc of the town quite suddenly. Yeah, there's a preacher over there prophesying without any clothes on. You guys are very happy that I put something on the outside and that I did more than just, you know, just enough. God has done that. He's given us of this beauty on the inside that we might be clothed with his glory on the outside. Hallelujah. Today I want you to be equipped. I want you to be equipped to stand before God with all confidence and certainty and boldness. To be able to come before the throne, the holies of holies, with absolute boldness and confidence and assurance. Knowing that it's not your righteousness, but it's his righteousness that he's clothed you with so that you might learn righteousness. So that that kind of relationship doesn't diminish. It doesn't in any way become compromised. It's just there, it's settled, and you can have great confidence towards the Lord, knowing that his obedience will abound unto many offenses. I mean, his obedience will result in that events of our failings or our shortcomings not resulting in a separation that took place when Adam and Eve disobeyed God, but there is a mercy and there is a grace. Now, I want to paint a picture for you, so I want you to open your Bibles to Exodus chapter 25. Let me paint a picture, and I'm going to paint one that God painted. I'm going to do a sculpting today that God did. This is an interpretive sculpting. Hallelujah. Prophetic sculpting that God did to show us something amazing, because it is a reoccurring theme throughout both the Old Testament and the New Testament. So look at Exodus chapter 25 with me. Hallelujah. How many people in here this morning, you righteous even as he's righteous? Yes. Hallelujah. How many people in here this morning, you holy even as God is holy? Yes. That is an amazing thing when you can lift your hand and know that it is not something that you claim of yourself. It's that which was gifted to you by the grace of God, because your Redeemer lives and you've accepted the redemption that he has provided, something that we could never achieve. But Paul went about to try to achieve that. And with the law in that legalistic fashion of how that God's pure and holy covenant basically got turned into more tradition and philosophical ideologies, here he went about to try to establish his own righteousness and never submitted to the righteousness of God as a gift. That was his plea, you know, in his cry to God for the nation of Israel after that he encountered the righteousness, Christ Jesus, the righteous. He suddenly went from a place of trying to have that good standing before the Lord, the highest level of acceptance, that which whose eyes are so pure that he cannot behold iniquity. Suddenly, he was given that purity. Now, he learned that who shall ascend to the hill of the Lord? Those who have clean hands and a pure heart. And the dedication to God's demand to walk in uprightness and to walk before him and be perfect in the covenant. But now all of a sudden, he encounters the Lamb that has borne away all of his sin and all of his iniquity and imparted to him his very own life. And so that's why he cries out to the church at Galatia. In Galatians chapter 3, he says, if there had been a law that could have imparted life, and he's talking about the life of God, then righteousness should have been by the law. But now, here we are, having received the bread of heaven, and we get to partake of the bread of heaven, and we do it by as symbolistically by communion, and saying that we are partaking of God's own life and the blood, partaking of his own flesh, of his own body, of his own being, finding all of ourselves in him. He invites us. He says, come live in my house. And he's got a big house. And it's better than the White House. You understand? It's the divine house. It's the glory house. And he says, I got a room all for you, all fixed up for you. Come dwell in me. Come abide in me. And this is God's call to every one of us. And somehow people get sorted out. Some people get sorted out because they don't feel worthy. Some people get sorted out because they feel condemned. They feel somehow that they don't measure up. My measure's in Him. Your measure's got to become in Him. You've got to find all that you need, all the grace that you need, all the mercy that you need, all the love that you need in Him. And if you don't, you'll never know this boldness and this confidence that I have. You'll never understand or hear the word of God that is being preached on the severity side as well as on the generosity side. You'll always hear it wrong. You'll always be trying to measure up instead of bowing before Him, coming before Him with your lamb that has received and the impartation, as it were, of all your sin, who has become you and you've become it. The innocent, you have become the innocent, and the innocent has become the guilty. How do you see that? That's the sacrificial system of the goat, of the bull, of the red heifer, of the lamb, of the turtle doves. The innocent, that which is pure, that which has never faulted, becomes the guilty, and the guilt and the guilty becomes the innocent. Listen, it's the exchange of life. He exchanged His life for our life so that we might exchange our life for His life. This is how you live. This is the covenant. This is drinking the communion cup. This is eating the communion bread. This is the light that you've got to grab a hold of. This is the battlefront of every demonic power. This is the battlefront of every evil spirit. This is the battlefront of every condemning thing now coming up against you. Try to steal from you that which God has given you and me. His confidence, Christ Jesus. When you have it, your shout's going to get louder. And when you have it, the flow of the Holy Ghost is going to become more free, flowing through you. When it's yours, you're going to have an empowerment to overcome sin that you didn't have before. Because I tell you right now, when you're feeling condemned and unwanted and rejected and somehow just a failure, you know what? Satan abhors that. And he is able to move into that. And he's able to just put upon you and impose upon you everything that he wants to impose upon you, because you're sorted out. You're broken off of the fellowship. The fellowship and the communion is just found in, you know, you being able to say to the Lord every day, Lord, I thank you that you love me so much. You know, sometimes, you know, I love to tell the Father, Lord, I love you so much. I love to tell the Lord Jesus, Lord, I love you so much. But there's something bigger than that. That is a result of me understanding and knowing and being able to say, Father, I thank you that you just are so in love with me. It is amazing that you're so in love with me. That you're so in love with me that you find no fault here. God found fault with the first covenant. He finds no fault with this one. Amen. He has brought full provision to you and me. That if we'll grab a hold of the covenant and understand His faithfulness and His mercy and learn to walk in His faithfulness, His mercy towards Him and towards one another, we continue to go on in a place of having the blood of Jesus Christ washing us and continually there as that mercy in which God is enthroned upon. So Exodus chapter 25. Let me give you this before I go too much deeper here. And I'm starting at verse 17. And let me just tell you this. There's a word used here. The Hebrew word is kippurit. And kippurit was thought for many years in traditional Christianity to mean cover. But reality of it is by the 1800s, late 1800s, that was capitulated. It was discovered, no, kippurit does not mean that. And fortunately, even approximately 300 years before that, those who were translating the King James, the Geneva Bible, and a few other Bibles, they got it right, and they kept kippurit as mercy. Okay, as mercy. Although there's many words for mercy in the Hebrew language, chus, racham. All of you, a bunch of different words for mercy. Kippurit stands as one of the big highlighted words for mercy. And I want you to look at this here as we describe mercy. Look at this painting. Look at this sculpting. And he says in verse 17, and you shall make a mercy seat, a kafurat, a mercy seat, a place to say, a seat is a place to sit down. Huh? Say that. Say a seat
is a place to sit down.
Okay. So if you could just grab a hold of this, because I've watched over and again, I've watched as people just sit and they listen to things and it goes through their mind and their thinking realm, but it never becomes of their heart realm because their mouth never said it. I'm going to say it again. I've watched as people sit around in the thinking realm because folks just believe that they understand how it all works. I tell you right now, there's only one who understands how it all works, and it's God Almighty. It's God Almighty. And people believe they can have things by just thinking it. God says you can't. You got to speak it. Okay, you may not make sense to you, but guess what? I can prove to you that most things that God believes doesn't make any sense whatsoever to you. And that you get to be a beneficiary from all of his blessings just because you participate with them. Just because you do what he says. Not because what you and I do is we imitate our culture. We imitate all the people that are around us. And God wants to change that. And he wants to teach us to imitate him. And so you're going to have to learn how to be a good follower. You have to learn how to follow. And that's a very difficult thing for Americans to do. Very difficult for Americans. But we pray that just at your state, you're not a bunch of cans.
Right.
Hallelujah. But your wellsprings created in Christ Jesus.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Devoted to imitating God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. To start doing what God said to do. If God said to do push-ups, start doing push-ups in the meeting. No one understands it, but God said do push-ups, so we're doing push-ups in the meeting. He didn't say that. He said give thanks and praise. Nobody understands that, so they don't do that. But God has said to do it. God has said to speak it. That the word confessed to our mouth produces something in our lives. Hallelujah. It hooks up with the faith of God that has been sown as a seed into a heart. Hallelujah. And it results in all the good blessings of his salvation. He says to us, he says, you shall make a mercy seat of pure gold. 2 cubits and a half shall it be in length, and 1 cubit and a half in breadth. And you shall make 2 cherubims of gold. Of beaten work shall you make them. The two ends of the mercy seat, and you shall make 1 cherubim at one end, you'll make another cherubim at another end. God loves redundancy because he simply wants to make sure you get it correct. So he's going to say it in a number of different ways. And he says, and the cherubim shall stretch forth their wings on high, covering the mercy seat, and their wings and their faces shall look one towards another, and they shall look towards the mercy seat, and their faces shall face each other. And you shall put the mercy seat above the ark, and the ark shall that you shall put, and in the ark you shall put the testimony that I shall give you, the law. And there I will meet with you between, and I will commune with you above the mercy seat, between the 2 cherubims, which are upon the ark of the testimony of all the things which I give you in commandments to the children of Israel. You shall also make the table of shittim wood, 2 cubits, the length thereof, the breadth thereof. You shall overlay them with pure gold. You shall put a crown round about it. And you shall make unto it a border of a hand breadth round about it. And then he goes on to describe a little bit more of just the detailed works of the actual ark itself to contain the covenants of the law. So I want you to look at 2 things. Number one, the mercy seat is enthroned above the judgment. Can you see this? The judgment is the law. God says those who do them shall live. Those who do not do them, you shall die. It's the judgment of God, and the strict judgment of it and the strict justice of it demands everybody be put to death. And yet, you know, you could see over and again, even under the old covenant, where God says, like in Ezekiel, to Ezekiel chapter 18, he says, the wicked man, if he turns from his wickedness and he does that which is right, none of his wickedness shall be remembered which he has done. And vice versa, if a righteous man should turn from his righteousness and do wickedness, none of his righteousness which he's done shall be remembered. For he'll be judged based upon what it is he's actually doing right now at the time. God will then hold him accountable and call him that. If it's wicked, wickedness. If it's righteous, righteousness. So there's mercy there, because here's the commandments of the law. God's commandments, the strict severity of the law, this is what you're going to do. And you know, there really wasn't too much difficulty there, was it? Was it really? It wasn't very challenging, was it? God's basically saying, I want you to love me. Are you listening to me? I want you to love me, and I want you to love people around you. I want you to do what's right concerning life, and I want you to do what's right towards me and towards the people that are around you. I don't want you to have any other gods, because there's no other gods, and all that's going to be is demon worship. So don't do that. Are you listening? I mean, these aren't difficult things. I want you to leave your neighbor's wife alone. You know, I want you to leave your neighbor's property alone. Don't go thieving and stealing their stuff. I mean, just real basic stuff here. But man can't even get that right. And he justifies his wrongdoing and then wonders, why is it that I've got so much problems and catastrophe and crisis in my life? Because you can't do the simplest things right. But they're rejoicing over the judgment is mercy. Their joy is rejoicing over the judgment. No. Now look at how this mercy is, and it's important. You got to look at how this mercy is sandwiched between the judgment of the law, that written law of God, say those who do not do this shall be put to death. And there is the cherubim staring at each other. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, the cherubims are the ones who are the protectors of God's anointing and of his glory. They're the ones who they're guarding the tree of life with a sword coming out saying, and burning. They're burning with the fire and the glory of God. Alongside of them is a wheel inside of a wheel full of eyes. These guys don't miss nothing. Talk about peripheral vision. They got it every which way. And it's a fire consuming within itself, a burning fire, and the sound and the movement of them is like the voice of the Almighty, a great bursting of noise. And they move, because of course, you know, Ezekiel described them better than anyone did. They were just terrible and awesome in their presence. And they the ones, everywhere God goes, everywhere he's sown is they there. They like were in Ezekiel's vision, they were bearing up the throne. It's like the throne was resting on their shoulders. And here they are. They're standing over the mercy of God. Here it is. The mercy of God is there sandwiched between this awesome judgment of God. I'm going to tell you right now, God's wrath will be poured out upon the ungodly. I'm telling you right now, the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God. I'm going to tell you right now, they that do these things, everybody's got all these different opinions. There may be different opinions about what it means to walk in the Spirit. And as many as are walking in the Spirit and led by the Spirit, they're the children of God. And as many as that don't, they're not the children of God. And all these people have these various different ideas and philosophies about what it means to walk in the Spirit. But this is one thing certain. You walk in the Spirit, you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Period. Everybody's got all these ideas about what grace will bring and what grace will do. A grace that has come from God teaches us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust and live righteously and godly. We've got all these ideologies, but God says it very simple. The unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God. They that do these things, the wrath of God abides on them. And you can, if you want to go, and it is be very good for you, if you haven't memorized these verses of scriptures, be very good for you to memorize these verses of scripture that you find, for example, in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, beginning at verse 9. Also in Ephesians chapter 5, beginning at verse 3, with an emphasis on verse 6. Galatians chapter 5, verses 19 through 21. You need to grab a hold of these things and understand what it is that God is saying. The absolute certainty that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But here, Father has made a way for us to be righteous. Amen. He's made a way for us to be pure. Yeah. He's given us a pure heart. He's made us holy even as he is holy. He's given us the gift of holiness so that we can learn how to walk in it, because we're not going to practice sin. We're not going to give ourselves over to iniquity. We find ourselves there sandwiched. We're there living in the mercy seat of God. We're there living in the mercy of God. We're there because God's mercy is there rejoicing over his judgment. His mercy is there poured out to everybody who will receive. Amen. But it's in an intense environment. Yeah. It is in an intense environment. It's a cherubim looking at you saying, I'm going to kill you. If you come anywhere near and you violate these, anything near to the sacred, and you violate that which is sacred. And the judgment of God, the law that is settled forever, God's ways and his conduct saying, they that do these things shall live, and they that transgress against him are worthy of death. You know, and that's why a big part of why Paul says in Hebrews chapter 12, he also says it in chapter 6 and in chapter 10, but he brings out the severity, also in chapter 3 of 2 Corinthians, he brings out the severity of God's judgments, and he says, listen, if those who heard the word of Moses were to die being testified against by two or three witnesses, of how much worse judgment, of how much more intense judgment should you and I be thought worthy of if we reject the word that has now come to us from God himself by our Redeemer, by the one who's been became the mediator between God and man, the Savior, the one who became our sacrifice to take away all of our sins and give to us his innocence to exchange his life for our life. I pray today that you'll get yourself redemption, yes, that you'll feel justified, yes, that you'll get yourself some righteousness and holiness and acceptance before, yes, God, so that you can come on in and begin to enjoy the pleasure that is in his presence. Because if you can't have what I'm talking about of this holiness and this righteousness and this justification and this acceptance and the beloved, you can't come in and begin to enjoy this pleasure, and you're going to go hunting pleasure elsewhere. And I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to end up destroying your soul forever. You've got to learn righteousness. I had a person call me last night, and he's having congestive heart failure. They didn't think he was going to make it through the night. His heart was only working 40%. He had fluid in his lungs. He was one time a preacher. He backslid. And then he came back to the Lord. But he just constantly had this perpetual backsliding. You know, anytime he got around pornography, he had to take a little peek. Anytime he got around somebody smoking hooch, he had to have a little hit. You know, he just always had little compromises. And, you know, he would walk good for God, with God for a couple, two, three, 4 weeks, and then he'd fall into the thing again. And, you know, every time God's mercy is there. But you know what? Father demands. He has provided for us all that we have need of. All that pertains to life and godliness, because he's called us to this glory and excellence of character that Peter talks about in 2 Peter chapter 1. He's given us the ability to learn this. And it's not some kind of hardship, some kind of crisis, hang me up by my ankles and beat me in the shins. It's a pleasure. It's a joy. It's abundant life. It's inheriting the blessing. It's doing what's right when you don't even know what to do what's right. You just obey God. And because you did what's right, you're going to reap everlasting life. You're reaping good stuff because you're sowing good things. And you didn't even have enough smarts to know how to do that. It's just you took hold of the word of God. And when the temptation and when the situation arose, you just went back and defaulted to the word and said, I'm going to do what you said, Lord. Yeah. That's not hard. The way of the transgressor is hard. People who've never known the pleasure of fellowship with God, and they've only known the pleasure of fellowship with demon spirits, are going to every time capitulate to demon spirit and the fellowship of all this stuff. And I said to him, when I called him last night, I said, are you ready for heaven? I mean, I know that, you know, he and another man of God both had contacted me. And I know the first thing you want me to do is to pray for his healing. But the first thing I said is, are you ready for heaven? He said, I think so. That ain't good enough. No. I tell you right now, that ain't good enough. If you think so, if you think God will accept you, if you think God loves you, if you think he might, you can't fellowship with him. There's too much wiggle room for the devil to defeat you there. There's too much wiggle room for blockade against your soul there. I said, and so I began to reason with him of God's love and God's mercy. And he's listening to me. I said, well, God's going to give you another opportunity. He's going to put a stay on this thing. You're not going to die tonight. He didn't die last night. It was tough. Didn't die last night. I said, but you've got to learn righteousness. Because right now, what you are is a person who falls upon the mercy of God, but you've never learned how to do what's right. You're being willing to rely upon his righteousness and his goodness and his faithfulness and his mercy. And that's all well and fine, and we need that. But that is empowering us to learn to do what's right. It's someday you got to quit taking a toke of the smoke. And someday you're going to have to turn your way, eyes away from looking at that which is causing you to do those things which are an abomination unto God. Amen. And I told him, listen, I'm here, I'm dedicated to you. You know that I am. I'll help you. I'll help you in every way that I can help you and encourage you. But there's no help like the help of the Holy Ghost. There's no prayer warrior like the prayer warrior Christ Jesus who ever lives to make intercession for you and me, to pray for us. Come on. Learning how to rely upon him, learning how to have him as a brother, as a companion, as a mentor, as a guide, as a protector. Come on. You need help. I know the helper. I know him. I know him personally. And the way that he helps me and the way I find great help in him is any condemnation, anything that tries to make me feel like I'm separated from God or I'm distant from God or God, I'm not special to God. Listen, I know who's doing the talking. And I know that that is the only thing that can keep me from all that God has for me. It's already freely been given to me. So I shut that thing down. Listen to me, dear people, because this is where people are taken out. They say they don't know how to move forward with God. They don't know how to walk with God. They don't know how to rely upon God. You learn how to rely upon God, you're going to find yourself enough strength. You learn how to rely upon God, you're going to find yourself enough help, enough ability. And relying upon God is a place where you've been redeemed. You've been made right with him. You've been made holy and acceptable. You in a standing with God that is everything that you need. I mean, somebody said it's imputed. And then the other person said, no, it's imparted. I said it's both. I got both of them right now. They're mine. It is accounted to me. It's given to me. And it's imparted to me. It's alive. I'm not choosing between. Hallelujah. I'm taking the sum total of everything that God said who he is about me and towards me, and I'm saying it's mine right now, and I'm not listening to anything else. Why? Because it is the means of my fellowship. And without fellowship with him, without companionship with him, we can't win. Oh, we fail. I heard someone say, and I got after him today too, they said, the spirit without the truth is witchcraft. And the truth without the spirit is legalism. And I just went after him. I said, come on, God, make you radical for the things of judgment and mercy to execute righteousness in the earth. Oh, hallelujah. People, that's one of the things that we have over and again being shown to us. Everything that you do is literally a witness to you of who you are and where you're at. All you got to do is, discernment is easy. Prophetic utterances are easy to discern. All you have to do is look what's going on in your life. I praise God for the people that are in here. You faithful people. People are constantly breaking covenant and going elsewhere, doing this and doing that thing and walking away from relationships. All that shows you is that you don't believe in a faithful God. You practice unfaithfulness. You've never learned faithfulness. God wants to teach you faithfulness. For faithfulness and truth are joined together and cannot be separated. Hallelujah. God wants us to learn mercy. He wants us, mercy will eradicate and erase every bad thing that anybody ever did towards you that would give you an excuse to walk away from him in the first place. Hallelujah. You know, I love, if you really want to get an understanding of mercy, go read the book of Hosea. Go read Hosea, where the Lord just basically can't deal with the harlot Israel anymore constantly. She's worse than any other harlot. Ezekiel joins in. She's a harlot that won't even demand payment. In fact, she doesn't demand payment of those that she gives her favors to. She pays them. And so she's the worst kind. And God uses a very terrible word there that I'm not going to use. For your sanctified ears. He used a very terrible word to describe her. He says to Hosea in that context, he says, go marry a woman who's a prostitute and secure her unto yourself so that Israel may understand how it is that I've been showing her mercy. He wants to espouse us to him in truth and in righteousness and grace and in mercy. I want you to look at a couple of verses of scripture here with me as just understanding this. And if I could get you to walk in covenant with God, if I could get you to be holy and acceptable to God, you'll quit finding problems with people. The very moment that you quit finding problems with people is the moment in time that you have received mercy from heaven. Because once you receive mercy from heaven, you can find no fault no more. You could, if you start to think something bad of somebody else, you'll say, I'm far worse. Far, far worse. Far worse. And they will become righteous to you immediately in your eyes. They will be esteemed above yourself. Hallelujah. Once you've received this mercy. Hallelujah. Open your Bibles with me quickly to Micah chapter 6. Micah. Now, man, I know it's kind of hard to find. You know, in fact, you know, I just turned right there. Micah chapter 6, verse 8. It's amazing how that happens, you know. Just open the Bible. There it is. Here's what Papa says. Here's what he's done. He made us like him. He gave us his heart. He went looking for a man after his own heart. He went looking for a church after his own heart. He went looking for a you and for a me after his own heart. We're looking for a people after his own heart. He kept saying to his people, circumcise your heart and learn to do what's right, and they wouldn't do it. So he went looking for a people. He tried to find somebody who would make up the hedge, who would bridge the gap, who would intercede. He could find none. So therefore, with his own arm, he sent forth his Redeemer, salvation, Christ Jesus, to create within us a heart who would know him and walk with him, would keep his judgments and his statutes and his commandments. And what is all of that? Sum total, it's walking in his love. Yes. Three yeses. 60 people looking like they're standing in the midst of a storm. Two turtle doves. One French hen. People, I want you to reach out and start grabbing a hold of God. You don't have to get loud about it. You don't have to get loud about it. I just don't want you to look like, I don't want you to look like you're daydreaming. I don't want you to look like you're in a storm. I want you to look earnest, like, yes, Lord, I'm taking that. Yes, I mean, you can give a little yes there. You can give a little yes. You can say, yes, oh God, you're good. I'm going to tell you, that is a revelation of his mercy, because you've taken and you've received it. And you've been willing to come out against everything that opposes that and take a stand and say, no, you will not work in my mind. No, you will not work in my spirit. No, you will not work in my thinking. No, you will not work in my action. And it's not one time. It's every time. It's day in. It's day out. And as you fight the battles, you wax valiant and fight. You get so strong that suddenly you find yourself not even having to deal with that background noise anymore. Don't even have to deal with Johnson and shot noise anymore. And the signal becomes far more sensitive when you shut all that background noise down. Hallelujah. Oh, come on, people. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life. Recognize who God is for you. Recognize that he who began a good work will finish it. Recognize having begun in the Spirit, you're also made perfect by the Holy Spirit. Recognize the Word of God and His strength and His power. Recognize a communion and a fellowship. Recognize all heaven has now been made available to you. There for your use. Then the most wicked states in America, or at least some of them, California, Oregon, coastal Oregon, and coastal Washington. You got to be careful the hotels you go to in Washington. You show up there and everybody's naked. No, it's crazy. It's crazy. We were going to check into a hotel. I said, this is a good hotel. We looked a little bit closer and everybody was naked. Fortunately, we looked a little closer on the web. Because we were going to be in that area. We're trying to find a hotel to go to. I'm like, my goodness gracious. And then I asked them. I said, oh, yeah, it's all over the place. This is a wicked place. This is a wicked region of the world. I believe if God's people get into a fellowship and a companionship with God where they can stand and say, if I be the servant of God, and I'm telling you right now, when Elijah said that, he wasn't doubting. I'm going to tell you right now, he knew what he was saying. If I be the servant of God, fire comes down out of heaven right now. Yeah. The miracles, the signs and wonders. I'm not that I'm saying I want to bring fire down on heaven, out of heaven on them in that way. I want to bring fire down out of heaven on them in a better way. The kind of way that Jesus ultimately has brought to us, that John the Baptist testified, he shall baptize with the Holy Ghost and fire. His spirit poured out upon all flesh. But there's got to be some people who know the Lord. Who know him. They who know their God. It speaks of an intimacy. It speaks of a fellowship, a companionship, a oneness, a partnership. You're in good. You're not on the outs. You're not on the bad list. You're not on the black list. You're in and you're close. And you said, I mean, I've been invited. God invited me. And I'm not crippled either. He invited me to come and sit at his table. I get to sit at his table along with all the mighty. And I'm not Mephibosheth. Are you listening to me? Come on. The son of a capitulated reign with broken legs. A capitulated kingdom. Heart of treason and transgression against the Most High. Still invited to come and eat at the king's table. I'm sitting here, man, in royal garments. I'm clothed in majesty and splendor. Bought with the blood, and I defy anything to try to say anything different. I'll kill it. I'll kill it with the sword of the word. Hallelujah. I'll take hold of it with the might of the Holy Ghost and cast it down with the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. There's nothing greater in power and authority than the word of God. I will come at it with the word. It will come to me with sword and shield, with great stature and height, with great fame of accomplishments in its warfare and defeat of mankind. And I will come in the name of Most High God, say, this is what the Lord has spoken. This is what the Lord has testified. He's God who sits upon the seat called mercy, enthroned there between the cherubims, reigning there, rejoicing over judgment. Hallelujah. Who loves me so much. And he wants to teach me his ways. And he tells me, he says, like in Matthew 5, verse 7, he said, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. I want to show you how to walk in mercy. I want to show you how to walk in judgment. I want to show you how to walk in truth. Micah chapter 6, verse 8. He that shows thee, he shows you men. He shows you, all men, what is good and what the Lord requires of you. To do justly, to do righteousness, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Jesus said to the Pharisees, he said, you pass over the weightier matters of what God wants in his rule of life, which we call law, to do justice, to love mercy, to walk humbly with your God. You can never do that until you have received that. That is a behavior that you can only have because you've been redeemed. And redemption is something that you hold fast to. You lay hold on eternal life. You lay hold on this life of God. And it is a grip. I have a grip. You cannot pull it out of my hand. I have a friend of mine that when his mother comes under the influence of the anointing of the Holy Ghost in special signs and wonders, was ever in her hand, not the strongest army could pull it out of her hand. It's as attached to her hand as her finger. I don't care how strong you are, you're not going to pull it out of her hand. It is a testimony for me as a laying hold on something. You grip it so tight. It's like it's a rope thrown to you in the midst of crocodiles. It is a rope thrown to you in the midst of a stormy, wavy, wave-ridden sea, and you're about to drown. You're not letting go. You're not letting go. I pray that you'll lay hold today on these words, of eternal life. You know, there's people that get sickness in their body. They get sorrow in their souls. They get situations and circumstances and they pray, oh God, deliver me, and it doesn't seem to be a deliverance. It doesn't seem to be at that moment in time a release from it. But you have to consider that the Lord has the right to test and has the right to try, and he's going to see. And because many people will begin to doubt what he did for them at Calvary over those things. Many people will begin to doubt what he did for us in the resurrection because of some other little testimony in their life. It begins to bring shame. There's no problem with saying, search me, O God, try me, see if there be any wrong way. There's nothing wrong with that. But always with that very heart, with that very testimony, we come back to the place where we are certain that God, if there was anything, God would have showed us then. It's one of the most important things. I'm trying to close this because there's a lot of things in my heart that I want to say to you, speak to you, tell you, and try to make up for the time of not being here and try to help you understand how to move forward with God. Because there's places people are just understanding how to cast your care upon the Lord, how to commit your ways unto the Lord and know that he's going to take care of it. When you're praying about something, you're asking the Lord for direction. You just say, Lord, I want you to give me direction. I thank you for your direction. I thank you for showing me exactly what to do. And you're not acting like you got to hear the word right now. You just pray that, and then at a time, a point in time, God will show you, you'll know exactly what you're supposed to do. You'll find yourself doing the right thing. Just walking with God in this place of confidence and trusting him, knowing that he's with you and he leads you and guides you, and nothing can separate you from him. Nothing can pluck you out of his hand. He's there upholding you, keeping, will not let any of your feet slip. Such confidence towards God results in the exploits of his goodness and his glory being made manifest through us. The worst part of sin is it threatens that. The worst part of wrongdoing is it threatens that. But get over in the fellowship, and I promise you the sin and the wrongdoing will become less and less to where it doesn't even exist. Hallelujah. The fellowship too sweet. The glory and the anointing too divine. Somebody says, I want more anointing, then learn to love righteousness and hate iniquity. Hallelujah. And you're not going to do that but by the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Only by him. Yes. The arm of flesh has been shown to be insufficient, inadequate. Somebody said, I don't know if I'm relying upon God, the Holy Ghost, or it's just me. I said, well, are you? I can tell you real quickly, I have the test. Are you successful? Are you winning? They said, no. Well, I'm not. And sometimes I am, but most of the time I'm not. I said that it's all you. Then the question is, well, then how can I learn how to rely upon the Holy Ghost? You have to be redeemed. You have to receive redemption. You have to be made right. You have to be made holy. You have to be made just. You have to be made true. You have to be made righteous. You have to be made one. You have to be made accepted in the beloved. Then you can walk with God. You can fellowship with God. Because he's holy, holy, holy. And nothing unclean. And nothing with a defiled conscience can come in here. Oh, you've got to learn to take communion and live by communion. You got to get your unleavened bread out. And anytime something starts to mess with you, take yourself a little bite. And get your cup of fruit of the vine out, your grape juice out, and anything that tries to violate your standing with God and your relationship with him, you take yourself another sip.
Right.
Hallelujah. If you could just learn these simple truths, if you could just learn these simple things in God, that he, by himself, redeemed us with his own might, with his own power, with his own body, with his own blood.
Yes.
So that you and I could learn to do what's right. God is so good. Hallelujah. God is so good. Hallelujah. God is so good. He's so good to me. Hallelujah. See, there's two ways to sing that. There's one way to sing that where you're trying to remember what the words were. And you're thinking about what you did when you were in Sunday school. And there's another way to sing that in which it just rises up out of you. Look at what God has done. Look at what God has done. Look at what God has done. Look what he's done for me. One last verse of scripture, because I've quoted it a number of times here this morning, and I want you to leave with it. And I pray that you'll grab a hold of the context. Listen, people, if you're not daily giving yourself to the study of the Word, change that. Because His Word is spiritual food, and you want that. It's strength and it's empowerment. It's enlightenment unto you. It allows you to see, and it develops your ability to see that much more clearly. And it doesn't take much, people. Listen, even if you really just are really weak at Bible study and reading the Bible, just, you know, 5 to 10 minutes a day and you can get through the Bible in the year. And it just basically amounts to about 2 or 3 chapters of Bible reading a day. And in 1 year, you're through it. And it's not going to be too long. You do that for a couple of years and you go, wow, this is really good. I feel a lot stronger and healthier than I did when I just had popcorn for lunch and supper and breakfast, or when I had, you know, a pop, you know, Twinkie and a, what is that other little thing, huh? The black thing?
Ding dong.
The ding dong. I had a ding dong and a Coke. And once a week I went and got a hot meal on Sunday morning when the preacher preached. Now I'm feeling all healthy and strong and spiritually fit. I'm having good food and nutrition every day. Oh, if you could just learn to just hold your appetite, to have one chapter of the Bible before each meal or right afterwards, because you need to sit there and let it digest a little bit before you get up and start running around anyways. Are you listening to me? In 1 year you would be through the Word of God, you'd be more fit, you'd be stronger. All of a sudden you'd begin to understand the power in prayer. You'd begin to give yourself to like 10, 15 minutes of prayer a day, and after a year or two you find yourself so much stronger on the things of the Spirit. You go, my, I figure I need double that. This is getting good. You go to 20, 30 minutes and you find growth and maturity in life, because God does these great unimaginable things through what may look simple and almost meaningless. And how can that work? And how can that really result in all these things of God's glory being made manifest in my life? Because it's a function of fellowship. It's a function of hunger and thirst. Something that's so spiritual. It leads us in a whole nother way of living, and a whole nother way of thinking, and a whole nother way of perceiving, and a whole nother way of interacting. Otherwise, you're stuck in a natural demonic world that's going to impose its stuff upon you at its will. And you must learn righteousness before you die. You must come to a place. God's not allowing you to be tempted above what you're able. And you've got to come to a place in God where that temptation comes that has taken you out over and again. And you say, no, I'm walking with the King. Father, thank you for this fellowship and for this glory. And you begin to worship Him. You begin to have that wonderful interaction that only the Holy Spirit can supply. Amen. You have to come to this. Just like the preacher, backslidden preacher, that I talked to on the phone last night, who the doctors were concerned whether or not he could make it. Because when your heart's just shutting down, there's not a lot they can do. They can inject you with all kinds of stuff. And here he is alive this morning. Will he hear after so long a time as this? Or will he continue to be a perpetual backslider? It's something that is developed in the early ages of life, especially for people who were raised in church. I've dealt with many people who weren't raised in church. They were raised in heathen families. You know, some of their parents were just hippies. Some parents just business people, just workaholics. And they encounter the Lord and everything has changed. And they look at Christians who are continually perpetual backsliding and they go, I don't get it. What's the difference? I've had many people ask me, what's the difference? Why is it that when I came, I never knew Him before. I never been to church. And I encountered Him. Everything changed in my life. And I look at these people who they were raised in church and they can't get their feet underneath them in terms of relationship. What's the difference? I want you to consider that. I want you to think about that. Because perpetual backsliding, a continual backsliding, is a spiritual disease that can become almost incurable. You don't want to give yourself to that.
No.
It would be better for you have to not known the way than to know the way and turn from the truth. It'd be better for you to not have been hanging out and feeling all comfortable around God, because you were raised in somehow, you were raised in some sort of compromise. Some sort of thing got into your life, some demonic stronghold got into your life and somehow justified sin and made it okay for you to be so unable to stand up against the demonic spirits that God knows you're able to stand against, because he won't allow you to be tempted above what you're able, tested above what you're able, but will with that temptation make a way of escape so that you may be able to endure it. And with it, it's always a crown of righteousness. You endure it, there's a crown of righteousness. There's honor in God. God will honor you. He will honor you. God wants to honor us. God wants to honor you. God wants to honor his church in the Western United States. The mighty men are afraid of Western United States. Many of the mighty men. I talked to mighty men and said, come to the Western United States. We're not coming to the Western United States. When you're used to having thousands of people come out and you come to the Western United States and 100 come, you don't want to go. Can't blame them. There's too much more profit to go everywhere elsewhere. Well, I always look at it. I don't ever look at it as, I don't ever feel bad or rejected. You know what my response usually is? Well, let's just watch what God will do.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Let's just watch what God will do. I don't get into argument. I'm getting in strife. I don't start saying, you pathetic loser. You, I can't even, where's your valiance? You know, or anything. And there's people that are coming. Cruises will be here next weekend on Sunday. Joe and Becky Cruz. They come back from Asia for a week and on the way to Hawaii, and they're going to be here for Sunday, next Sunday. Hallelujah. God sends people to help. But my heart is so stirred to see a people rise up who knows their God, who walks with God. If sin has you and can take you at its will, you can't have the glory. You can't have it. You can talk about it. You have a lot of knowledge, but you can't have it. You got to learn how to stand up against it. You got to understand there's a great reward in seeking God. Seeking God is just obeying God. It's obeying God. Seeking God is obeying God. Seeking God is doing what's right before him. Setting your face to seek the Lord. Hallelujah. By obedience. Praise the name of the Lord. James chapter 2, verse 13. I'm going to close with this. Just look at this verse of scripture. Hallelujah. I can hardly move towards the Bible right now. Just the presence of the Lord. Power of God's present here right now to save you, to redeem you, to fill you with all righteousness and all holiness, to empower with you with such a divine presence that it's like rivers busting out of you. Many people have said they stepped into Pentecost, but they've not had it. They've not had Pentecost. They've not had Pentecost because they've not been willing to let the foundation be established in their life. They can't go on to perfection because they don't know the doctrine of Christ. Hear me. Leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection. They don't understand the principles of the doctrine of Christ. I'm in him and he's in me. I'm a new creation. I'm one with him. I'm holy and acceptable unto God. I'm his righteousness. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I've been established in righteousness and true holiness to be holy even as he is holy. To be allowed to come in and behold that which nobody was able to enter into and see, that the seraphim must veil his face when he stands before that glory. Only one angel has the right to behold the power and the glory of God. It's the cherubim that said. Only one. Only one creature. To stand and behold the glory. Oh, mighty God. Oh, mighty God. To understand these things and live in these things, I pray that you'll lay hold on them.
Yes.
They're yours. You may have them. Yes. You don't have to beg God for them. You just receive them.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
If you'll just receive what he has to give,
yes,
you'll have an authority to be a son, yes, because you believe on his name.
Thank you, Jesus.
And my goodness, what an authority to be a child of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. In the cross, be my glory ever, and my raptured soul now finds this joy flowing in the river. I pray this is your heart. I pray that you haven't found a dull and boring life. A life that causes you to reminisce of former days when you were lost in sin and iniquity. But that you have found a life that causes you no longer to bring into remembrance those things of the former conversation and lifestyle and manner of life. Many have come to church and they've never found what I'm talking about. Many by the tens of thousands sitting in churches today across America, and they've never experienced what God declares in His Word that is so much more wonderful. It's like heaven compared to hell. It's so much more wonderful. It's a life so much more glorious. James says an amazing context here. And if I started back up and started talking about the context, you'd be here the rest of the afternoon. So speak ye, verse 12, and so do as they that shall be judged by the law of freedom. Whew. I'm not going to talk about that. We'll have to talk about that later. For he shall have judgment without mercy. That's called justice. Do you hear me? Yes. Judgment without mercy is called justice. In the strictest sense, you pay in full for your sin, for your wrongdoing. Judgment without mercy is the hard, cruel justice of the law. And he says, for he shall have judgment without mercy upon those who have not shown mercy. God wants you to learn mercy. Yes. He wants you to do what's right. Learn to do what's right. He wants you to learn how to walk in love. He wants you to learn something that you can only see at the Kippurot, the place where God will meet with men. He wants you to learn to do something that you can only behold at the place where sin is purged, iniquity is done away, where the blood is applied, the mercy seat. The mercy seat. You have to see the mercy applied to you, a relationship that makes you every bit whole. Every bit whole. Every bit. Every bit whole. That where now you are complete in Him. Now you are complete in Him, what Paul said to the church of Colossians. You are now complete. I am now complete in Him who is the head. Come on now. Come on, a little bit more joy. Don't take me to sad land. I'm happy over here. I'm not sad. I'm not moaning. I'm not trying to get redeemed. I've been redeemed. Just keep me happy over here. Keep me happy. Don't draw me into sadness. Huh? Come on now. Keep me happy. Come on. Find a happy song. I don't let anything pull me away from this realm. Not a song, not a music, not a thing, not an activity, not a desire, not a wish, not a want, not a cry from another land. I'm staying over here with Him. Listen to me. Listen to me. Hear me. Hear me. There's a mercy that you're only going to be able to get because you received it where redemption was applied to your life. Redemption and sin and iniquity was forever, forever removed. And their sins and their iniquities, I will remember no more. Stand with me. Happy, 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 happy. You can play something like Joyful, Joyful, We Adore You, or anything that is happy, anything that is happy. But it's got to be happy. God loves you so much to people. He loves you with an everlasting love. Say, God loves me.
God loves me.
With an everlasting love. You know, it's too many times folks, they just forget who God is and who God showed himself to be. Moses wanted to know who God is and wanted to understand more about the fullness of Father's glory. And he passed before him and he said, I'm the one who's full of compassion, full of mercy, long-suffering, full of goodness and faithfulness, or the word truth, which is always combined with faithfulness. Emit, full of faithfulness. Come on, can you just come in? You can sing the song that you were, you can play the song that you were playing when we started church or whatever, anything. Just happy, happy. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command you to be happy. Right now, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I command you to be reconciled unto God, to go free from your sin, to go free from your iniquity, to come into a place of fellowship with Him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Anybody standing in here today, God, I just want you to understand Father loves you so much. And He doesn't want you to walk out of here living the way you've been living, walking the way you've been walking, powerless, unable to do what pleases Him. He's invited you to come live with Him. God the Father has invited you to come live in His house. Christ Jesus has invited you to come live, come dwell in Him. All you have to do is say, yes, I want that. But you cannot have that unless you're willing to be redeemed, because you can't come around Him with all defiled, messed up conscience, all bringing in all your trash. God wants to wash you, cleanse you to where you have no more sense of sin anymore. Where it's been removed off of you, where you His, He is yours, you're in the holies of holies, and you have a right to be there. You're in the holies of holies, and nobody can kick you out, especially the cherubim. Are you listening to me? Nobody can kick you out. God is calling. Jesus said, I've come that you may have life and that you may have more abundantly. I come that you may have a life better than anything that Satan could ever put on you, anything that you could ever find. No matter if you have the ability to discover it all anew, I still got a better life for you. If God gave you 1 billion years to go discover a better way, you would still say that His reaches far beyond. What will you do? What will you do with Jesus today? What will you do? Those of you that are standing in this place, you've never found the ability to say no to sin. Temptation comes and it takes you over and over again. Today, God is challenging you to learn righteousness. He wants you to know He's empowered you, and you're going to have to start changing your ways. You're going to have to start doing it His way. If you're too busy to do what God's commissioned you to do, then I'm telling you right now, you'll never find this life that He's freely given. He's called you to come walk in the Spirit. He's called you to come live out this wonderful relationship with the Holy Ghost. Come on now. Come on. The angels of the Lord appeared and said, peace on earth, goodwill towards men. For unto you is born a Savior, Christ the Lord, today in the city of David in Bethlehem. Somebody forgot. They didn't say curse on you. You guys ought to be really sad. You ought to be ashamed of yourselves. Peace on earth, goodwill towards men. The sacrifice has come. The Redeemer has come. The Savior has come. The Healer has come. Today, I want everybody standing in this place, you watching me by web, where are you too? Salvation has come. He's the Redeemer. Redeemer means He changes everything about who you are. You are standing, your life. He's Healer. He'll change everything, every part of your being, and make it whole. He's Redeemer. He brings complete and total reconciliation. Today, if you're standing in this place and you're not certain about your standing with God, you're not certain about who He is and His love for you, let Him change it now. Let Him change it now. Let Him change it now. Let that yoke be broken off of you right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Anyone standing in here, you've never called on the name of the Lord Jesus. You never cried out to the Savior, the Redeemer, and said, Lord, come and deliver me from my sin. Come and deliver me from my iniquity. God's calling you right now. And I pray that everybody in this place, that there would come such a Holy Ghost conviction upon you. That there would be such a Holy Ghost conviction in your life. That sin and the things of darkness won't stand a chance. I'm certain that if we'll walk in such Holy Ghost conviction, it will be ministered through us. To be partners and heirs with God, to be honored by Him, to have the privilege of being those who stand in His stead. The deception that blinds your eyes from looking at the glory of it and the splendor of it. I break the curse of it now. I break the curse of that deception now. Because there could be no higher position. There could be no greater honor than to be honored by God. To be able to live and walk and abide and dwell in His anointing. Oh, masatera masala pokonani andadeshti. He's calling you right now. If you haven't been baptized in the Holy Ghost since you believed, you need to hear the message of Paul as he addresses the disciples at Ephesus. And the first thing he says to them in Ephesians 19 is, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? And they didn't know anything about it, so he laid his hands on them. They all began to speak with other tongues, heavenly languages, and prophesy. We just lift your hands towards heaven. Let God touch you right now. We let Him touch you right now. We let Him touch you right now. We let the Lord prepare you right now to begin to send you to your family with His love and with His mercy, with Holy Ghost conviction power. Will you let God touch you right now, begin to send you to your work community, to your neighborhood, your neighbor, that is who your neighbor is, anybody you encounter, with His love, with His mercy, with His goodness, with His Holy Ghost conviction. Will you let God begin to send you to a lost and a dying world that is in such need? Can you show redemption? I'm asking you a question here. Can you show redemption? Can you reveal redemption? Do you know what redemption looks like? I challenge you, every person in this place, I challenge you by the Spirit of the Lord to come to understand what redemption looks like. Because the redeemed of the Lord return and come with singing unto Zion, everlasting joy is on their head. They have obtained gladness and joy. And sorrow and sighing is fled away. He is the desire of all nations. They want to get rid of their sorrow and sighing, but they do not know how. They want it on the basis of their own terms. come to Jesus. Come eat of his flesh, drink of his blood. Come find all your worthiness, all of your righteousness, all of your holiness in him right now. Right now in the name of Jesus, I command strongholds to leave. Right now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command sickness and disease of the body to leave right now. Right now in the name of Jesus, I command there to be a true repentance. A true repentance. A true turning to God right now. A true repentance. In the book of Acts, when the people heard the gospel, they brought their computers and their smartphones and their keys to enter into other demonic realms, their books and their knowledge and their interactions with things that belong to the demonic. And they burned them with fire. They destroyed them. They destroyed them. John said, bring forth fruits that are evidence of your true repentance. Bring forth a testimony of it. When Reinhardt and others do big meetings in Africa, Friday night is the time for everybody to bring their stuff and burn them, to bring their idols, to bring their charms, to bring the things that have been for them a stumbling block, the things that has caused them to enter into sin, to burn it, to destroy it, to put it away from them. If there's a stumbling block in your life, literally the Greek language calls it the scandalon, from which we get scandal. There's a scandalon, if there's a scandal, a stumbling block in your life. If you're not willing to remove it from out of your life, then there is no true repentance. And there can never be redemption without repentance. There can never be redemption without repentance. There can never be redemption without repentance. God has called us to turn from iniquity and to turn from sin. God has called us to recognize and understand that when he purified us, he purified himself a people from all iniquity and caused them to become zealous of good works. He redeemed us, purifying us from all iniquity, making us a people zealous to do what's right, to walk in his glory, walk in his power. Put it away from you. Put away the unholy thing from you. Put away the unclean thing from you. Put away the scandalon from you. Put away the relationships that are wrong relationships. Put them away from you. Put away the compromises. Put them away from you. Put them away. And if you do that, heaven will come fill your life. Heaven will come fill your life. I'm going to wait just a few more minutes. Because I want that disease of perpetual backsliding. And there's some people in here today that I recognize this. You are creating an epidemic. And if what's going on in your life spiritually was actually to show up in your body physically, you would be hospitalized and you would be desperate. You'd be so weak. The terminal disease would make you so weak. The medical examiner's report would be that you don't have long to live unless there's a miracle. And you'd be so desperate for God to come heal you. Do you're a young man or a young woman in this place and you've not learned how to walk right with God, you've not learned how to just take hold in the simplicity of your life as it is now, because it's going to get a lot more complicated, believe me. If you cannot walk with God in the simplicity of your life now, you will never walk with God. There's provision now, plenty. You're going to have to get real with God. When I was young, I used to like to take people out into the wilderness, out into the desert, who had problems with sin, for a week in the desert. Bible, water, tent. Suddenly temptation is so strong. They come back, they get in their living room, they got a refrigerator full of food, television, all the rest of the stuff, and they're right back into the mess. Then you need to live in the desert. It's east about 30 miles. That's where it begins. Go. Flee from the wrath that is to come. Lay hold upon the refuge. Whatever you got to do. Whatever you have to do. My wife, we had to do a transition out of Las Vegas yesterday. She said, it's the plains, city of the plains. I said, baby, it's worse than that. Because Sodom and Gomorrah was actually great grasslands. They were great grasslands. It was a habitable place. Las Vegas is in a place uninhabitable. It's in the desert. Nothing lives there except for the lizards. I don't even think Gila monsters. You have to go towards Lake Mead to find them. It's the desert. It's the desert. Nothing can live there. But in the midst of this place where sin abounds, in this fiery furnace, a pool of all the demonic hordes. Now the scripture says this, it says, I beheld among the young men those who were foolish, who had no wisdom. They went in at the door of the harlot, whose door was the gates of hell, that went down into hell. And there they never returned. And the Lord has made that very clear to me. That pornography in what the God of this world has set up to entice men is that realm. The Lord spoke to me one day and he made it clear to me concerning these things. He says, my right hand shall find those who hate me. I will seek them out. Once again, redemption produces within us the righteousness of God, that we may learn righteousness. And we're not talking about deciding that you're not going to sin, that you're not going to trying to come to terms of making a decision that you're not going to be involved in adultery and fornication anymore and witchcraft. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I wonder. I speak now aloud because many people in Israel could not hear. Many people today in the church cannot hear. The proof that they cannot hear is because they've not received the remedy, the cure. The cure. The cure. The blood is the cure. The resurrection is the cure. And yet we see the epidemic at work. I said the blood is the cure. The cure. Have you been cured? God's talking to people in this place. Have you been cured? There's people who have not been cured here. you still have pleasure in unrighteousness, whom God said, I will destroy. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 10. I will destroy them. If you have pleasure in unrighteousness, you have not got the cure. You've not got the cure. I had a man sitting by me on the airplane the other day, and I was talking to him. He said, you know, I was in and out of church all my life. I was raised in here in San Diego, PB. He's in his 60s. He said, but 2 years ago, I had an encounter with God. He said, all the things that I've allowed in my life all these years, alcohol, playing around with certain drugs like marijuana, pornography, he said, they're not in my life anymore. He said, I know that you're a man of God. I want you to tell me. He said, if I would have died during those days, he said, I would have awakened in hell, wouldn't I? I was not right with God, was I? I went on to talk to him about the goodness of God, but he said, are you not going to answer me? He said, no. I said, no, I'll answer you. I said, the goodness of God that leads men to repentance has you here right now. He did not sit in a church like this. He did not have the anointing of the Holy Ghost and men of God and women of God around him like this. He did not. He's just in a Baptist church. God's talking to you now. Do you have the cure? Some people do not have the cure because they've never got real with God and repented. They've never brought their sin and laid it upon Jesus Christ. Some people have never brought their sin and their iniquity and laid it upon his head and said, Jesus, take my sin now. I lay it upon you, body, and I lay it upon your being. Give me to me your life. This is repentance. This is what it means to respond to the altar. God's pleading with you. He loves you so much. Without question, his love. And to step over into this place, whew, of such boldness and confidence and assurance, to step over in this place of the cure. Oh, ha-ha. I said to the Lord one day when I was about 20, 21 years old, and I said, Lord, if I would have known that it was this wonderful, that it was this glorious, it was this good to know you and to walk with you, I would have come so much earlier with this surrender and with this abandonment to you. I was raised in church, but I always knew the difference between the cure and the disease. Do you hear me? I didn't sneak around with God, and I despised those who did. I despised them. I despised those who sang and worshiped in church and went out to live like the world. I despised it. And I believe it was a holy thing, even though I was, had more judgment than mercy. And then, because of that, it had a bad effect on me, and I turned away from God and didn't go to church for a while. God in his love and his mercy came and got me. Let me tell you something. There's nothing that outrages God more than to have his name profaned. Nothing. Nothing. For someone to stand in a place and say, I know the Lord, and this is what it means to be baptized in the Holy Ghost, and to come stand upon this platform alongside me, to turn aside in sin and iniquity, I don't want to stand anywhere near you. Because the judgment of God is certain. And I'm making sure that everybody understands plainly what I'm saying here in the context of God's goodness and His love and His righteousness and mercy. There's some people that need the cure here in this place. There's some people that need the cure here in this place. There's some people that need the cure. You need the cure. In its bringing forth evidence that you've repented. It's getting rid of those things in your life at any cost. It's making those commitments. And there in that place, as I've said and spoke to you this morning by the Spirit of the Lord, being there empowered. Because so many people have taken the message of God's grace and turned it into lasciviousness. Over and again. Over and again. And that is the deception of America right now in the Western world. It's the deception. If you want to live in the grace, you've got to have the cure.
Yes.
If you want to be empowered to overcome the world, you've got to know the fellowship and receive the righteousness and be righteous, to find your whole identity in righteousness and holiness. That's the cure.
Amen.
That's the cure.
Thank you.
I want to make sure everybody hears me today, because the altar call response wasn't what I hoped it to be. So I'm just making sure everybody plainly understands me. God loves you. He's dealing with you. He's calling you. But every day that you refuse to hear His call, the sound of His voice becomes fainter and more faint. And you know what fills the place in the void of that call and that voice? Sound of religion. Becomes louder and louder, and self-justification louder, and God on your own terms more perfectly defined. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I break off those strongholds.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I renounce every unholy and ungodly thing, is what you need to say in your spirit. I renounce it. If you need to say it, I renounce every unholy and ungodly thing. I know for certain I'm dealing with demon power right now. Demon power is ruthless. And you know you have it. If you rise up from this place and you go back to iniquity and you go back to sin and it takes you at your will, at its will, you know you have it. This cure will bring you into a place of empowerment.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And you may stumble. Maybe. God not wants you to, doesn't want you to. It's just stumbling because you didn't give all diligence to making your calling election sure. Because He says, you give all diligence, you won't stumble.
Amen.
I'm going to give you God's word on it.
Yes.
God's word on it. He upholds you and none of your steps will slip.
Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
None. None.
Amen.
None. You get the cure here today. You get
yes.
The cure. Don't leave here today without the cure.
Amen.
Don't leave here today. Don't eat and drink damnation, which is deception to your soul. Don't eat it and drink it. Don't eat it and drink it. God knows when you're serious, when you're serious. No matter what it costs. And it doesn't cost much. Just take your sin and put it on Jesus. Lay it on Him. Lay it on Him.
Yes.
Lay it on Him right now.
Yes.
Just take your sin, lay it on Him right now.
Yes.
Take your sin, lay it on Him right now. Receive His righteousness.
Yes.
Take your sin, lay it on Him right now. Receive His righteousness.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
listen to me. In closing, I'm going to say this again. You cannot afford to run the risk of spending eternity without God. If I can just get people to be convinced of an eternity, if I can bring people to a place in God of a revelation to be convinced of an eternity, either with or without God, men will get serious. In that place of sincerity, God moves He moves in the realm of sincerity, which is truth. There you find His salvation. Sure, you find the cure. How long, how many years does God work with men? To bring them to a place where they love His righteousness, His purity, His holiness, His goodness. Where they say, I turn my back on sin. I turn my back on this world. Father wants you to see the mercy seat. He wants you to see the place where your sin dies, expires, is put to death, is removed. 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 When it's removed and you see it removed, you an overcomer now. You empowered now. I don't believe I'll end this altar call today, says the Lord. Parents, grab a hold of God for your children's sake. Because your doubt and your unbelief works within their life. Imprisonment. The sin that you allow in moderation, they will allow in excess. Grab a hold of God. Be an intercessor. Grab a hold of God. Grab a hold of God. He loves you so much. 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 Father loves you so much. He spared not His only begotten Son, but offered Him up for the sins of us all. And by Him, He shall also freely give us everything that we have need of to be what He's purposed us and called us to be, to live in the paradise of relationship, the paradise of fellowship, where sin becomes exceedingly sinful. It becomes the demonic, ugly twistedness it is. The Lord said, with the pure I will show myself pure, but with the twisted I shall show myself a violent man. Hear it. Hear it. I know King James translated that psalm with the froward, I will show myself froward. But the Hebrew language is very clear. The pure I show myself pure. That's me. But with the twisted, the crooked man, the one still bent on wickedness, the one who allows demonic desires and ideas to work in them, I will show myself violent. In many respects, the Lord says, same way, I will fight against the proud, but to the humble, I'll give grace, I'll give divine ability. Hear me now. If some of you die this week and we never see you again, we may weep, but our weeping will not change your eternal fate. And I would have wished that I would have pled more intensely. I've been here before. I know people who've been in the meeting who's dead and in hell now. I've had too many people in my life that I've known that died in their sin. I'll be 58 years old this year, this in February. I've watched a lot of people come and go. This stuff is repeated again and again and again and again. Too many times we still see the few, whereas the many take the wrong road. The few that respond. Will you be the few? There's not many here today. If everybody here today would say, Lord, I'm laying hold on you, I'll bring forth evidence of my repentance. I'll lay hold on the cure. I know I have the cure. You know, somebody said, how do you know you have the cure? Because I overcome sin. We overcome iniquity. We overcome the evil one. If we don't have the cure, if we don't overcome sin, because we're all tempted, we're all under the barrage of the assaults of the enemy. But some of us have the cure. Do you have the cure?
Yes.
Do you have the ability to say no to the devil and his iniquity? Has your life been made whole? Are you pure or you're twisted? You're right or you're wrong. Your light or your darkness. Your life or your death. You in Christ, are you in the realms of the demonic? As far as I'm concerned, people need to just stay right here. It's called, for me, it's called the altar call consciousness. The altar call commitment to say, no, I'm right. I'm going to be right with you, Lord. I'm going to walk right with you. I'm going to get this right. I'm going to live in all holiness and godly fear. California, Oregon, Washington, the Western United States is probably in worse condition than any states in the United States of America. And Father wants us to be the cure. So you're going to have to get cured to be part of the cure. And every temptation that you face, you're going to have to confront it as the means of demonic power that has come to shut your ability down. The means of demonic power to keep you from ever knowing this fellowship with Jesus Christ. This redemption, this relationship, this glory divine. The Lord said, I will heal you. I will deliver you. I will give you a new heart and a new spirit that you may keep my judgments and walk in my statutes and keep my commandments. Whew. Today, decide. Today. We plead with you today. Let these things be settled in your spirit. Let them be settled in your heart. Oh, Mama Sete Arama Sikaba. I want everybody just to come, and I want you to just come kneel before the presence of the Lord with me. Just come kneel before the presence of the Lord. I know there's not much of an altar here. The whole place is an altar. Just in surrender and consecration to the Lord. Some of us can kneel today not only on our behalf, but we can kneel on the behalf of others. You tell the Lord that you want Him to be able to have in you the life He purchased to produce. He paid to have a kind of life in you and me. He paid in full. He paid for it. And today, I want you to just lay aside the things. I want you to lay aside the weight. I want you to lay aside the sin. I want you to lay aside the things that you've allowed to run interference. To whatever it is, if there's anything, any area, you lay it aside. You lay it aside right now. Let's just lay it aside. Because Father is so wonderful, He's so glorious. If we just bring forth the evidence, the sincerity of repentance and truth, which I believe by and large is represented in this room right now, He's promised to bring us His mercy, to bring us His cure, to bring us His redemption. And we're dedicated to seeing You get established in righteousness and walking in the cure. But let me tell you this. You listen to me. Don't let anyone fool you. Don't let anyone fool you. Especially people who've been raised in church. And church has become common to them. But the relationship has not become beautiful and everything that they want. God looks upon the heart. He wants truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden parts He would teach us to know His ways. Those are synonyms. He wants truth in the inward parts, and when the truth is there, He will teach us to know His ways. Everybody that's on your knees right now and you're crying out to God and you're willing to make things right and you've confessed the Lord Jesus Christ and you believe in what He's done for you and you know that you've been born again and you know that you're a new creation and you know that you're right with God, then you accept that righteousness and you accept that holiness, and it's not your righteousness, it's His righteousness. It's not your holiness, it's His holiness. And now every day be empowered to live in it. And there walk in the light as He's in the light, and the blood of Jesus Christ will cleanse you from all sin. And if you sin, He's faithful and just to forgive you. You got a mercy seat. You got a mercy seat. There is a mercy seat, a mercy that's rejoicing over judgment. But I'm having to deal with the two extremes right now. I'm having to deal with the extreme of God's people who've not somehow been able to live in the being made right. And seeing their righteousness as His righteousness and their holiness as His holiness. And those who've not received the cure, because it's always the extreme, it's always the tension. You try to talk to both communities of people. And those who should be standing up strong in righteousness, all of a sudden they start thinking that they need the cure. And those who need the cure start believing that they can stand up in righteousness. And it's a difficult situation. But today God will open up your heart, and then you open up your understanding, and you're going to get made right. And every stronghold is broken in Jesus' name. And everything that was allowed in your life that is not of God, be allowed no more. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Say, Jesus.
Jesus.
Thank You for Your precious blood.
You are the bread of heaven.
You are the eternal life. And we thank You right now. That You washed us.
You cleansed us.
Thank You, Holy Spirit.
For Your glory.
For Your power.
For this new creation.
For this new birth. For this divine nature,
for this very glory
of God that now exists in my life. I submit myself to You. I yield myself to You. Father,
Your will be done.
May I be pleasing
and fruitful
in every good work.
Walking worthy
unto all pleasing.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Say, Father,
Almighty God,
Redeemer,
use me.
Use us.
Let Holy Ghost conviction rule our lives.
Let Holy Ghost conviction
sweep this church.
Be felt in every place that we go.
Communion and fellowship with you, Lord. That will not allow anything that offends you. In Jesus' name. Say, Lord, my body is your temple. Father, this is the place that you dwell. Holy Spirit, this is the place that you dwell. Lord Jesus, this is the place that you dwell. Be glorified in my body and my spirit, which are yours. Say, Lord Jesus, I will never stand before you again with my own righteousness. Father, I'll never stand before you again with my own righteousness. But I will stand with the very righteousness of Jesus. I'll never stand before you with a measure of my own holiness or the measure of my own life. But I stand before you with your holiness, with your life, no matter what comes. I accept what you have done. I'm in you and you're in me. I'm complete in you. I'm empowered by you. I live by you. Not by might. Not by power that men produce. Not by the might of my ability. Not by the power of my ability. But by your Spirit. But by your Holy Spirit. But by the Spirit of the Living God, which has been given to me, which I have now, which I possess now. Thank you for the cure. Thank you for the cure. Thank you for the cure. That the disease of sin is no more. The disease of sin is no more. The disease is broken. The power is broken. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. I just praise Him, give Him thanks. Listen, if you know someone who's struggling, and maybe it's someone in your family, friend, then you take responsibility for them. You get with them every day. You pray with them. Get them on the phone. Pray with them. So listen, we're going to pray. How are you doing today? I have preachers. I have pastors call me up just to say, listen, here's what's going on. Accountability. Listen, I need you to pray for me. Pray with me. You need to do that for one another. You need to find people around you. You need to be willing to be proactive for people. In the place, God has given every one of us a charge. You can't have my charge. I can't have your charge. Each one of us are called and given a charge based upon where God has us. And you just be faithful in doing what God has given you to do and taking responsibility for the realms of God's, you know, that God has made you accountable for and influential in. And He'll give you more. You know people that are struggling? You get hold them accountable. Get your arms around them. Say, how are you doing today? Listen, let's pray. I want to be here for you. I want to help you. We can do this thing together. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, I pray you come back tonight. I pray you spend this day rejoicing in Him.
Understand what it means to be redeemed. The redeemed of the Lord return and come with singing. So go forth singing and rejoicing. Mountains and hills will break forth before you. Go out with joy. Be led forth in peace. And the mountains and hills will break forth into singing. And all the trees of the field will clap their hands. And everlasting joy be on your head. I mean, come on. Hey. And if there's anything that's been too great for you, my goodness gracious, just mark that as just a lie. If there's a door of access that Satan has had in your life, get that. Destroy the door. I said, lock the door. Don't even have the door. You don't let the door exist anymore. You with me? Get it out of your life. Get it out of your life. Put it out of your life. God commands it. Put it out of your life. Cast it out from your midst. Amen. And watch what God will do. You'll find Father. Whew, he's more than able. Hallelujah. Well, amen. Well, we love you. Find a bunch of people, hug them, bless them, tell them that you love them. Worship the Lord with your tithes and offerings. See you tonight. Amen. Say, I got the cure. I got the double cure. Hallelujah. Kana kadiyana na mahaka de shiliya te danahate. Ah, masatili ni nana motus. Who's on backwards?